Okay, the final item of business this evening is a members' business debate on motion 14784 in the name of Claire Adamson on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and World Pancreatic Cancer Day 2024. The debate again will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite Claire Adamson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. An unusual night when we have two members' businesses back to back, but nonetheless, we have had a sea of purple all evening in the gallery again, with those coming here to recognise and mark World Pancreatic Cancer Day, which is the 21st of November 2024 this year, and also the fact that November marks Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. And I welcome to the gallery many people who I've campaigned with over the years, from PC UK, Don Crosby, Carol O'Connor, Ian Thompson, Wendy Thompson, Brian Green, and those with Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland as well, who have joined us this evening, Fiona Brown, Ross Carter, and as always the person who's inspired me to do this every year, Linda Murray. We know and have discussed many times that every year the issues around pancreatic cancer, why it is such a problematic cancer, and why it's so important that we shine a light on the issues around it every year. Pancreatic cancer feels like it has been left behind, receiving just 3% of the UK cancer research budget. And we also know that Pancreatic Cancer UK's recent announcement of nearly £600,000 in funding for research taking place in Scotland into early diagnosis and treatment for the disease is very, very welcome, and acknowledges how important this will be, as we know that only 3 out of 10 people will receive any treatment after diagnosis, the lowest proportion of all cancer types, and acknowledges that we know half of people die within 3 months of diagnosis. This year, we've also been alerted to the fact that there is a shortage in the availability of pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, PERT, directly affecting the quality of life for those living with pancreatic cancer and other conditions. Commend the health professional and pancreatic cancer charities coming together to develop a holistic support and guidance on what to do if a patient is running low or cannot get PERT, and I'll discuss that further later on. But as always, we must thank the campaigners in the gallery who worked tirelessly during the year, raising funds and highlighting to the public and educating the public on the symptoms of pancreatic cancer. We also like to thank those brave campaigners who have shared their experiences over the years of their loved ones, but also of their own situation with pancreatic cancer. Very few survivors can come and speak to us for all the reasons I've just outlined, but there are people who have managed to survive for over 10 years, or it's a very, very small part of the pancreatic cancer community. But we need to shift the narrative, as always, and better outcomes for people living with pancreatic cancer and the devastating impact it has on one's personal life needs to change. It's the deadliest common cancer in Scotland. 7 in 10 people, sorry, I've already said that, only 1 in 4 people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer survive beyond 1 year. The 5-year survival rate in Scotland is only 7.3%. Across other cancers, this is an average 5-year survival rate of 69%. And this is the quantum, the scope of the issue with pancreatic cancer and why we have to shift the dial for those who have been diagnosed. There are around 900 people in Scotland every year diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and over 10,500 cases in the UK. It is the 12th most common cancer in Scotland, but it is responsible for the sixth highest number of cancer deaths, a disproportionate effect for those who are suffering with it. Hard to treat and clear need for research must be a priority. Cancer Research UK notes that the overall survival rate has, with most cancers, has doubled in the last 50 years. However, survival rates for pancreatic cancer have barely shifted. More than 80% of people with pancreatic cancer are diagnosed at a late stage. And this emphasises the need for targeted research so we can better understand the pathology of the disease and improve the whole treatment pathway and patient support. The PERT shortages, which I mentioned earlier, PERT is a capsule that can help people manage digestive symptoms of pancreatic cancer, cystic fibrosis, neuroendocrine cancer and pancreatitis. It's taken with food and it replaces vital enzymes which help people break down and get nutrients from their food. It does not happen naturally for those with these illnesses. The absence of PERT can have a devastating impact on people's lives. Without access to PERT, people can become malnourished and even literally starve to death. In the last 9 months, there have been intermittent shortages across the UK, and this is expected to be an issue until at least 2026. This is due to a lack of the raw material used to make PERS and limited manufacturing capacity. So we are calling on the UK government to develop a national action plan to proactively address and resolve PERS shortages. The UK government must ensure that UK's PERT market share matches the demand for PERT across the UK, and this includes ensuring alternative brands of PERT are imported where required. I'd like to also mention the Scott HPB pathway pilot, and I know Ross Carter, who has been fundamental to that pilot, is in the gallery this evening. The HPB Cancer Pathway is a diagnostic pathway pilot offering people diagnosed with pancreatic or liver cancer in Scotland the biggest hope that they will be able to access treatment as quickly as possible. And I restate, most pancreatic cancer patients are diagnosed very late in this stage. This is something that I have worked with and had the pleasure of seeing the work of Dr. Carter and Linda Murray, who have led on this for a long time. And I know that the government extended the pilot with a view to this being embedded into the pathways for the cancer going forward. And I'm interested to hear the Minister's view on what might be happening next with this pathway. So I would like again to thank all of the people in the gallery for all the work they do in highlighting the issue of pancreatic cancer, its challenges, and in educating people on the symptoms to ensure that most people are aware and get the help they need in a timely manner. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. We move to the open debate. I call first Miles Briggs, to be followed by Marie McNair, around 4 minutes. Mr Briggs.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking Claire Adamson for securing this debate again and for her campaigning on this issue. I think it's important. A number of us have spoken annually in this debate, and I welcome the fact that we do have that commitment. And like Claire Adamson, can I also welcome to the public gallery this evening the many campaigners who have really pushed the Parliament in the right direction on this issue. And I think it's really important we recognise them really as the advocates and crusaders around pancreatic cancer. And we know why they do this, and we know why many of us want to speak in this debate. And that is because each of us will know an individual family member who we have lost, or an individual work colleague or a family friend, or even constituents doing this job. And that's why we want to see things improve. And that is something I know all of us across all parties agree with. And in most years, this debate around Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month will be consensual and will point to welcome progress being made. But I feel this year is different. And that is very much having spoken to campaigners and the briefings which we've had ahead of this debate, which are raising serious concerns, as Claire Adamson mentioned, with regard to ScotHPB and the future opportunities that presents. And it's something I think we need to raise in this debate, and something I want to, in the time I have tonight, concentrate my remarks on. Because as co-convener of the Cross-Party Group on Cancer, I've been made aware of the concerns over a move to a regional approach rather than the national approach which was being developed by government very effectively, and I think really welcomed by many people working in the cancer community. But it does feel that that is now under threat. And looking at Pancreatic Cancer Action's briefing for this debate this evening, they specifically make reference to the fact that in December 2023, a week before Christmas, the Scottish Government did surprisingly announce they were cancelling the project, despite significant improvements around outcomes for patients. That, however, thanks to campaigning by patients and many in the public gallery, did see the Government eventually reverse their decision and restart that project. Fast forward to now, where we sadly see the Golden Jubilee and others being ruled out as the national host for that. And really pushing towards just being available to go back to a regional model being reverted to, I think that would be a step backwards. And I really hope that ministers, in responding to this debate, would really consider where we are today and where that national approach can be taken forward. It sits, I think, really positively within the government's cancer strategy to try to develop that. And we know the positive outcomes which this can have, specifically around decisions to treat being taken with the multidisciplinary teams which are developed. And we know the need for that, specifically around pancreatic cancer. So I hope, in terms of a call to action, which we've had from charities and campaigners, that the Minister, in responding to the debate, will specifically look at what's been outlined. I know she'll be acutely aware from these briefings as well of these concerns, but also agree to meet with the charities and MSPs who are involved in tonight's debate to discuss this situation, because I am concerned that the great progress we have made in Scotland, some of it really world-leading, is now at risk. And we need to prevent that and make sure that we get this back on track. We know, as Claire Adamson has outlined, that outcomes for pancreatic patients are still not improving at any rate. This was the model which could help address that, and we need to make sure that is protected and taken forward. So I welcome this evening's debate, the opportunity for us to raise these issues, and again, congratulate all involved with this Awareness Week, but also the work which they do all year round. We should make sure that that is something which is celebrated and really acknowledged by Parliament this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. And I call Marie McNair to be followed by Carol Moch in around 4 minutes. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to my colleague Claire Adamson, MSP, for securing this incredibly important debate during Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and ahead of World Pancreatic Cancer Day later on this month. Since being elected in 2021, I have spoken in the three previous debates on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, brought to the Chamber by my colleagues Claire Adamson, MSP, and Willie Coffey, MSP. And it is an issue that I will always feel is so incredibly important to speak on. And I'd also like to extend my sincere thanks to the wonderful charities. Obviously, we've got Pancreatic Action Scotland here tonight, and also the good work from Pancreatic Cancer UK and other dedicated organisations who are at the forefront of raising awareness and fighting for better outcomes for those with pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is unfortunately a silent killer due to the early symptoms being difficult to spot, and only one in four people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer survive beyond a year. And that's why raising awareness is so crucial to detect this cancer early and to improve patient experience and overall outcomes. Therefore, Presiding Officer, I feel it is important to reiterate the common symptoms. These are a yellow tinge to your eyes or skin, darker urine, paler poo, itchy skin, loss of appetite or losing weight without trying, feeling tired or having no energy, a high temperature or feeling hot or shivery. Education is a powerful tool in the fight against pancreatic cancer, And while their understanding of the disease is somewhat limited, there are factors that can increase your chances of getting it. Factors such as smoking, obesity and family history can increase your risk of getting the disease. And according to Pancreatic Cancer UK, there are around 900 people in Scotland diagnosed with pancreatic cancer each year and over 10,500 across the UK. And these are our loved ones, friends and community members. These figures are bleak, but it's important that we highlight them to call more urgently for greater action, and clearly we need to do more. However, despite these challenges, there are glimmers of hope. We in Scotland are fortunate to have some of the best researchers and medical institutions working tirelessly to fight this disease. And therefore, I was welcome to read about the University of Glasgow and NHS Greater and Glasgow Clyde's recent pancreatic cancer research programme, which will evaluate a new drug combination as first-line treatment in patients with metastatic pancreatic cancer. This is a really important step in the pursuit to develop new treatment to improve the outcomes for individuals diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, and I really hope this proves successful. The Scottish Government is committed to progress too through the Scottish Hepatic Pancreato Biliary Network, which was awarded £653,000 over 2 years to redesign the pancreatic and liver cancer pathways. It is the first service in the UK delivering a national approach to improving the pathways of both pancreatic and hepatocellular cancer. The project has resulted in significant improvements in patient care in the majority of performance indicators measured across all 14 health boards. It is welcome that consideration is being given to exploring options for sustained delivery of its positive outcomes after March 2025. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'd like to conclude by paying tribute to my constituents who have sadly lost their lives because of pancreatic cancer. Helen, Donald, Billy and Christine will be forever missed by family, friends and loved ones, but never forgotten. And we must work together in their memory and the memories of others to do everything we can to raise awareness of this disease and push for better survival rates. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Carol Mochan to be followed by Willie Coffey. Around 4 minutes, Mrs. Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Claire Adamson for bringing this debate to the Chamber? And on behalf of Scottish Labour, can I mark Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and also World Pancreatic Cancer Day, which, as we've heard, takes place on the 21st of November. Raising awareness of illnesses such as pancreatic cancer is absolutely pivotal to ensuring early diagnosis and improving prognosis. And in the 3 years of being in this Parliament, I feel Claire Adamson has truly played her part in this, and I do really thank her for doing that. It was one of the very first debates I participated in, and I shared my story of a close family friend's experience. And I have been here with other members in the years since that, and I really appreciate how much you bring this to the Chamber. The key point that I would like to talk about is the fact that this is quite an urgent situation, and others have mentioned the reasons why, and I'll go over that. But we must make advancements in the treatment options and address the health inequalities in this often very late diagnosed condition. We have heard this evening, but I think it's worth saying again, that 80% of people with pancreatic cancer are diagnosed at a late stage, and more than half of people die within 3 months of diagnosis. We can see why much is needing done to raise awareness of symptoms, but also what a huge responsibility the government have to ensure the NHS in Scotland is in a position to encourage and support research efforts and able to do some very important work around that early diagnosis. We know from the debate today that urgent changes in research funding for pancreatic cancer here in Scotland needs to happen. And a lot of our briefings brought that point to members, and I'm sure the Minister will have had that as well. So I hope the Minister will respond to that point in her closing remarks. As the motion states, the £600,000 funding into early diagnosis and treatment is very, very welcome. But we do need to have confidence that more and continued funding within the research part of the NHS will happen. The advancements from research, I was reading the briefing notes in this area, cannot be understated, and I do thank all the researchers, but of course the patients and families who participate in the research, contributing to what can only be said as life-saving, valuable work. At this juncture, I really want to thank the various organisations who have contacted me and the other members ahead of today's debate with the briefings, and it just highlights the sheer scale of the challenge we face when it comes to recognising the way in which we have to move forward with some urgency in terms of pancreatic care. In my remarks, I do have to ask the Minister quite directly about the question, similar to my colleague Miles Briggs, about the closure or the potential closure of the national service known as the Scott HPB National Care Pathway. There doesn't seem to be, from what I have read in the briefings and when I tried to look at it in some other papers, no commitment after March 25 has been made. And I think it's important for us to understand what the government is considering. The concern is that if the service reverts back to regional guidance funding, regional guidance funding is precarious, regional variation will reappear and health inequalities will continue to worsen. Now, members will know I repeatedly raise the issue of health inequalities within the Chamber. So, Presiding Officer, what we know in Scotland is that those in our most deprived communities are more likely to get cancer and, tragically, are more likely to die from cancer. And this, I know we all agree, this is absolutely unacceptable. And so, in closing, I suppose I'm asking the Minister to consider if we can do anything that makes that better, then we should do it. And I hope that the Minister and the Government are making some successful decisions around that point. But I'll close by thanking Claire Adamson and other fellow members who have contributed to the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I call Willie Coffey to be followed by Finlay Carson in around 4 minutes. Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. And can I once again thank my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this year and for her very informative speech. I'd also like to thank all those who offered us briefings for the debate to help us get the message across about pancreatic cancer. As we all know, November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, and I'm honoured to have the opportunity to speak in this annual debate to show my support. We've heard from members across the Chamber of their personal experiences and their constituents' experiences too. And every year, Presiding Officer, I mention my mother, who died from this awful disease in 1985, gone far too soon when she was only 52 years old. So I feel I've also lived alongside this cancer for the past 40 years, and I don't intend to let go, just to tell the Minister that. Now, as we've heard, pancreatic cancer is probably the most stubborn cancer in Scotland. And it's important for us as elected members to use this platform to raise awareness to the public. Repeating the symptoms to look out for, I think, is really important, and catching the disease early could be critical. The difficulty is that a person who may have pancreatic cancer may not have any noticeable symptoms at all, or their symptoms may be really difficult to spot. And my colleague Marie McNair mentioned a few of them. Some typical symptoms may be loss of weight, loss in appetite, indigestion, nausea, even a yellowing of the eyes, a pointer to possible jaundice. And so the clear message to people is get in touch with your GP practice if you have any concerns. It's not certain, of course, that those symptoms mean you have the disease, but the earlier you get checked, the better. Now, the facts are, Presiding Officer, that 70% of people with a cancer never get any treatment, and Scotland seems to be one of the worst in this regard, and I don't understand why that's the case. So getting checked early and getting treated earlier can improve survival rates for this incredibly stubborn disease. So what's been done to try and overcome it? Cancer Research UK spent over £31 million in research in Scotland in 2023-24. £9 million of which was in pancreatic cancer. Now, during their trials, their results showed that giving chemotherapy after surgery for pancreatic cancer can almost treble short-term survival for people with the disease. According to Pancreatic Cancer UK, their Scott HPP pilot, which has been mentioned by members in the chamber today, resulted in significant improvements across all of the measured KPIs for pancreatic cancer patients. Improvements such as reducing the waiting time between imaging and starting patient treatment from 54 days to 38 days, reducing the wait time for patients with initial suspicion of cancer to diagnosis, and speeding up how quickly patients receive contact from a specialist HPB nurse are all part of the basket of actions that can help improve survival rates. Pancreatic Cancer UK has awarded almost £500,000 to researchers at the University of Glasgow to uncover why pancreatic cysts develop into pancreatic cancer. Apparently, around 10% of pancreatic cysts will develop into pancreatic cancer. And with just over 292,000 people in Scotland who are over the age of 60 who have a cyst, a pancreatic cyst, that's a frightening 29,000 people, presiding officer, who could go on to develop pancreatic cancer. So understanding how these develop into cancer is crucial if we are to reduce these case numbers. Now, I can't emphasise enough the need to maintain the successful research that we already know is working, and I firmly hope that the Scottish Government will be able to give some assurances on that today, if possible. Every year, presiding officer, the research seems to make good progress. Finally, thank you once again to my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing this debate to the attention of the Parliament, and I'm delighted to be able to make a contribution to this incredibly important subject again this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Coffey, and I call the final speaker in the open debate, Finlay Carson, in around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Claire Adamson for bringing this member's business to the Chamber today? It's important to raise awareness of all cancers and not to try and hide it under the carpet, as in the past, as we used to talk about the big C, as if we didn't mention it, then it might go away. And sadly, that is most definitely not the case when it comes to pancreatic cancer, which, as we've already heard, is one of the six less survivable cancers, and where action is urgently needed in Scotland that will lead to earlier and faster diagnosis, faster pathways and greater investment in research. It goes without saying that the work of the Less Survivable Cancer Task Force has been nothing short of remarkable and should be commended. As we know, the less survivable cancers are cancers of the lung, liver, brain, esophagus, pancreas and stomach. Annually, 9,000 people are diagnosed with a less survivable cancer in Scotland, some tragically facing an average five-year survival rate of only 16%. Encouragingly, Scotland is starting to lead the way for the less survivable cancers, although we cannot ever become complacent in this battle. Considerably more needs to be done to identify these cancers as a strategic priority in the 10-year cancer strategy. As I mentioned, we need to see earlier and faster diagnosis that will lead to the patient subsequently being treated much quicker. As MSPs, we must raise awareness of the less survivable cancers, not just during Awareness Week that runs from the 13th of January to the 17th of January, or on World Pancreatic Cancer Day on the 21st of November, when we will all once again wear purple, but whenever possible, like on this occasion. The current key area of concern for progress with pancreatic cancer is improving pathways for people with pancreatic and liver cancer. Unfortunately, half of those diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in Scotland will die within 3 months. The figure makes grim reading, given that every year around 880 people will be diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, with 810 of those likely to die. Sadly, the survival rate is not great, with almost 3 in 10 people surviving for 1 year or more. Late diagnosis is a common and hugely important factor influencing the long-term outcome, with the majority of cases identified at advanced stage, reducing treatment options and their survival chances. The Scottish Care and Coordination Service for HPB cancer is a very important solution to improve outcomes for liver and pancreatic cancer, and we can take some comfort in the knowledge that Scotland is leading the way in delivering expediting and supporting diagnostic pathways that will improve outcomes for these cancer emergencies. There is also much improved communication and speed with which GPs are being informed, with them being informed as little as one day, down from 31 days, with treatment pathways shortened by 37% on average. Specifically, the time to GP communication for pancreatic cancer is down 75% from 8 days to 2 days. The task force is now urging us to support the Scottish HPB Cancer Service as a national initiative, rather than reverting to a regional model which has historically been less effective. And Minister, I certainly don't want those diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in Dumfries and Galloway being pointed towards a palliative care solution rather than maybe an operative solution because of the financial implications, whereas that a patient in Edinburgh might be treated completely differently. Of course, it is the key reason for a national approach, including, of course, equity and access. A national model will also ensure uniform care across all regions, helping to reduce health inequalities, something that affects many people living in rural areas. And it can also improve cancer outcomes throughout Scotland. A single well-supported national team is more sustainable than replicating roles across regions. Shifting to regional delivery risks inadequate staffing and may lead to service gaps. As we are aware, Scotland has faced record-long cancer waiting times, something this SNP government should and have held their head in shame. But hopefully this coordinated pathway is a proven step towards addressing these delays. The nationwide rollout of the Scottish HPB pathway is vital to guaranteeing waiting times and equality to access to care for patients with liver and pancreatic cancer, signalling what should be the Scottish Government's commitment to high-quality, accessible cancer care for all. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think we should welcome the advice of experts and wholeheartedly provide them with the support and financial investment necessary for people to give them a fighting chance against this cancer. Finally, my contribution to this pancreatic debate has largely featured facts and figures, but that doesn't change the fact that it's friends and family who we have to put at the centre of our thoughts. And I've committed to contribute to this debate on pancreatic cancer every time it's brought forward in memory of my very good friends Mark Cagle and Peter Mariusha, who were taken far too quickly by pancreatic cancer and so dearly and are so dearly missed.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Carson. I now call on Jenny Minto to respond to the debate, Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing this motion to the Chamber today and for reminding us of the impact pancreatic cancer can potentially have on all of us. I think every single member that contributed talked about somebody in their lives that was lost to pancreatic cancer, and I think that makes us all, because I've had close friends as well. In addition, I'd like to thank Pancreatic Cancer UK and Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland and the range of other pancreatic cancer charities for their continued efforts in both raising awareness and supporting people facing pancreatic cancer. And I too would like to welcome their sea of purple to the Scottish Parliament, as Claire Adamson and others have. I'd also like to thank colleagues here today for sharing such valuable contributions to the debate. Willie Coffey and Marie McNair both listed the symptoms, which is really important when we are in this situation where we can use our positions to let people know what the symptoms are. And when I spoke in this debate in my first year in this Parliament, it was one of my constituent sister-in-laws that gave the very salient piece of advice I felt, which was to recognise and listen to your own body changes and try and do something about it. As has been mentioned, the Scottish Government published our ambitious 10-year cancer strategy in June last year. We remain determined to improve cancer survival rates and provide excellent and equitable care for all people facing cancer. The strategy takes a comprehensive approach in improving patient pathways in cancer, from prevention and diagnosis right through to treatment and post-treatment care. We continue to have a focus on the less survivable cancers, including pancreatic cancer, and improving their outcomes. And I too would like to pay tribute to the Less Survivable Cancers Task Force. As Willie Coffey and others have said, we know that research and innovation are essential if we're to continue to develop new and effective approaches to improve diagnosis and treatment of pancreatic cancer. Through our Chief Scientist Office, the Scottish Government supports grant and fellowship schemes for health research in Scotland. We're currently funding a clinical academic fellowship, and alongside the NHS Education for Scotland, have recently provided funding for a postdoctoral clinical lectureship, both at the University of Glasgow, into research related to pancreatic cancer. The Chief Scientist Office also provides a range of funding and support through NHS Research Scotland that allows health boards to host and participate in clinical research studies and trials. This helps to foster a strong research culture within our NHS, and we are currently supporting a range of clinical studies investigating different treatments for pancreatic cancer. In partnership with Cancer Research, we also co-fund the Experimental Cancer Medicine Centres in Edinburgh and Glasgow. These centres form part of a UK-wide network that supports the delivery of early-phase cancer studies. And I welcome Pancreatic Cancer UK's current research investment of over £1 million in Scotland, and I was pleased to hear their recent announcement of nearly £600,000 to support research into early diagnosis and treatment. As Claire Adamson and Carol Mochan both have said, this is life-saving and valuable work. As we know, November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. To mark this and World Pancreatic Cancer Day, we will again light up St Andrew's House in purple on the 21st of November. Raising awareness, as Willie Coffey has said, of pancreatic cancer and its common symptoms is crucial in detecting this devastating cancer early to ensure the most appropriate care and optimal experience for people with pancreatic cancer. We recognise how important it is that they are diagnosed and then supported through treatment and care as quickly as possible. As Finlay Carson and others have said, late diagnosis is a concern, which is why the Scottish Government continues to invest in our Detect Earlier, Cancer Earlier programme, because we understand that the earlier cancer is detected, the easier it is to treat. We re-ran our successful awareness campaign, Be the Early Bird, back in August. The campaign aims to reduce the fear of cancer and empower and encourage those with possible symptoms to act as early as possible. And by continuing to invest in cancer diagnostics and waiting times, we are striving to detect cancer earlier and faster. We are optimising diagnostic pathways and activating an additional rapid cancer diagnostic service early next year, bringing the national total to 6. And I think it's important to recognise that the rapid cancer diagnostic services are finding cancer faster, and the HPV cancers, which include pancreatic, are one of the most commonly identified cancers through these services, making up 17% of them in a recent evaluation. We acknowledge the dreadful impact that a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer can bring, both to the person facing the disease and to their family. The importance of person-centred care cannot be stressed highly enough. It ensures that all patients get access to support throughout their cancer journey and that their voices and needs are heard. The Scottish Government continues to support the Single Point of Contact programme in 12 sites across Scotland. This programme sets out to make sure that all people facing cancer have a constant point of contact that they can continually refer back to. This is so important in improving patient experience as they progress through investigation, treatment and post-treatment support. The single point of contact will ensure that patients are receiving timely and accurate advice on their appointments, tests and results. They will also offer the opportunity to discuss non-clinical support that's available, including linking them with other organisations that can provide the support needed. We have commissioned Healthcare Improvement Scotland to consider how we best scale up this approach to bring benefits to all patients. We've also invested, as has been highlighted earlier, in the pilot Scottish Care and Coordination Service for hepatopancreatobiliary cancers as a potential way to deliver pathway improvements. Our initial investment in this pilot was extended for a further year to March 2025 to allow us to consider how best to take forward the learning from this work. Following an extensive appraisal, we are actively considering how best to improve patient pathways in an equitable, evidenced and sustainable way. And I appreciate very much the points that have been made tonight. And I understand that the Cabinet Secretary is meeting with Less Survivable Cancers Task Force, Pancreatic Cancer UK, Pancreatic Cancer Action and the British Liver Trust later this month. I'm happy to meet as well, but I know that that is in the diary. Presiding Officer, to close, I would like to make clear the Scottish Government's enduring commitment to improving pancreatic cancer awareness. In doing so, we can improve early diagnosis rates, as well as improve patient experience and overall outcomes. It's crucial that we continue to raise awareness of cancer symptoms, particularly among those less survivable cancers, like pancreatic cancer. And I'd like to gratefully thank all those very much who are helping to do so.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.